come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. We welcome you once again to the sanctuary of St. James African Methodist Episcopal Church of Memphis, Tennessee, the church living out God's commandment to love through a commitment to serve. We are excited about being here once again this second Sunday in July in the year of 2023. Let's put our hands together and praise the Lord in this place on today. Amen. And let us now stand that we may join in our call to worship. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good. O Lord, I love the house in which you dwell, and the place where your glory abides.
The Lord is in the temple, let all the earth be silent before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
You! ditches. Bringing us the recovery of whatever that was holding us in bondage. And we say thank you. Breaking the chains that held us captive. And we say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for never giving up on us, even when we gave up on ourselves. Thank you for bringing us out of the darkness into the light. Lord, we don't know where we'd be without you. We are forever grateful for you opening our eyes, our hearts, and our minds. Placing your word in us as we read for understanding. Enlightening us. Reviving our spirit so that when we lift our hands in praise and worship, we're giving back to you what you gave to us. So we say thank you. Thank you that as each and every one of us take a step to heighten our understanding in you, that for every step we take, you've taken too. Lord, we can't thank you enough. We know that when we look around and we look at the news and when we hear the people talk, we know that we are in tumultuous times. But we know that you, and only you, continue to give us hope. We know that only through you, we have the victory. We know that Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But because we are in you, he has no victory. He has nothing new. He only used the old things. We know old things have passed away. We are new creatures in you. So we say thank you. Thank you for a new mindset. Even though when we look at ourselves, we see the person that we were. We see the face. But we know that within, we are new because of you. So we say thank you. Thank you for a new breath of life. Thank you for changing me. Thank you for giving each and every one of us not what we wanted, but what we needed. So we say thank you. Thank you that we were able to come into the house to give you praise, glory, and honor, because we know that without you, we are nothing. So we say thank you. Now, Father God, as we go into our worship service, we thank you for our pastor. Thank you that he continues to push through. Thank you for healing his body. Thank you for continuing to pour into him as he poured into us. And we say thank you. Thank you for everyone that's here in the sanctuary that came to worship. Thank you for those who joined virtual, because we know that when we come together collectively, we leave with a new mindset. And we can take this word and feed others. So we say thank you for everything that you're doing, everything that you've done, and everything that we've asked for. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
The word of the Lord comes to us today from Psalm 45. We're going to begin reading at verse 10. Psalm 45, beginning at verse 10. Hear, O daughter, consider and incline your ear. Forget your people and your father's house, and the king will desire your beauty, since he is your Lord. Bow to him. The people of Tyre will seek your favor with gifts, the richest of people with all kinds of wealth. The princess is decked in her chamber with gold-woven robes. In many colored robes she is led to the king. Behind her, the virgins, her companions, follow. With joy and gladness, they are led along as they enter the palace of the king. In the place of your ancestors, you, O king, shall have sons. You will make them princes in all the earth. I will cause your name to be celebrated in all generations. Therefore, the peoples will praise you forever and ever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
There will be mountains. Blessing, it may come tomorrow morning, but if I give up today, I'll go this way.
can't give up now. Amen. We praise God for our praise team. Our praise team. Amen. Amen. They put in some work this morning. Amen. And I'm thankful. I'm so thankful that I've got one of the best on this side of heaven. Amen. Bow with me in a word of prayer. God, we say thank you. We thank you, God, that we are here once again. We are thankful, God, that through many dangers, toils, and snares, through a whole lot of drama and a whole lot of trauma, we're still standing. We thank you, God, that the enemy tried to stop us. The enemy tried to stifle us. But just at the right time, you rose up in us. You lifted up a standard, God, and we say thank you. Now, God, as your word goes forth today, it is our prayer that someone will be touched, someone will be healed, someone will be delivered, someone will be set free in the name of Jesus. And we say thank you. Amen. The word of the Lord comes to us from Genesis, the 18th chapter. And I'm going to pick up at the 9th verse. It's kind of in the middle of the story, but we're going to talk about the beginning of the story at some point. But Genesis 18, beginning at verse 9. They said to him being Abraham, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he replied, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will return to you next year, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years. Sarah had stopped having the periods of women. And Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "Now that I'm withered, am I to have enjoyment with my husband so old?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I in truth bear a child, old as I am? Is anything too wondrous for the Lord?" King James says, is there anything too hard for God? "I will return to you at the same season next year, and Sarah shall have a son." Sarah lied, saying, "I did not laugh, for she was frightened." But he replied, "You did." For a theme for a few moments today. What's so funny? What's so funny?
All right.
One of the queen mothers of African American philosophy and literature, Dr. Maya Angelou, once said, "I don't trust anyone who doesn't laugh." Mm-hmm. And laughter is often described as good medicine. Laughter helps us to break down social barriers, religious and economic barriers. Laughter, it can be a common denominator in reconciling a relationship. It's a way for us to get rid of depression and sadness. Laughter is indeed good for all of us. But sometimes we laugh at the wrong time. Not long after I started preaching, I was in the pulpit of my home church. We were in the middle of worship, and it was during one of the choir songs. I looked up at the wrong time, and I have a bad habit. I always see stuff I'm not supposed to see. I looked up in the balcony just to see people hitting the floor. Literally, the pew had split in half. And my first inclination was to roll on the floor laughing, but I was in the pulpit. I wasn't allowed to do such a thing. Because on the surface, it looked like a scene from a Tyler Perry play. It looked like something you would have seen Brown and Cora and Lomadia didn't go to church, but you would have seen, amen, there was no smoking section, so she wasn't going to be in church. That's what she said. But that's what it looked like, was a scene from a Christian comedy play. And in that situation, someone like my mother or my grandmother or the pastor, if they would have seen me laugh, they would have roasted me, beginning with the question, "What was so funny?" For some people, laughter is a reaction to something that's shocking or hurtful or something that should make them angry or somewhere they have become confused. What it's saying is it's not possible. This can't be happening. This cannot be real. This cannot be true. The absurdity of what has happened causes us to laugh, sometimes hysterically. Our minds can't grasp it, so our brain sends a signal to our bodies, and we just chuckle or we holler out in laughter, and it's really not funny, but if we don't laugh, we might explode. Today, in our text, this is a smaller part of the Abraham narrative. We go back to chapter 15 really quickly. Abram tells God, since I have no children, I will make my steward, the one in charge of my household, my heir. And then God takes him outside and shows him the sky and reminds him that he will be the father of a great nation. He reminds him that your descendants will outnumber the stars that you're looking up at today. And in the 17th chapter, we go a little bit further. Ishmael is born. Once again, God tells Abraham, and by this time his name has been changed. His name was Abram, has been changed to Abraham. And he said, this is a sign to you that you will be the father of a great nation. And he also reminds him that even though Ishmael is a child with a promise, Ishmael is not the promised child. What God is trying to remind him is, number one, I don't need help doing what I'm doing. And number two, he wanted to let him know that I'm about to work this thing out. So, and I want us to note also, Sarah hasn't heard from God yet. Sarah doesn't know what God promised her husband. So when Sarah sets Hagar up with Abraham, she's just trying to have Abraham have an heir. She has no clue what God has said to Abraham. So Abraham is still being promised a natural heir, an heir that's going to be birthed through him and his wife. And as we enter chapter 18, God makes an unscheduled appearance as a mysterious messenger with two attendants who are just passing through. Abraham invites them in to refresh themselves, and they accept this. Now, before they leave, they ask for Sarah by name. And I want us to be clear, this should be a hint that something's about to jump off, because Abraham has never told them what his wife's name means. Abraham doesn't recognize them as being divine, but those of us who are reading or watching the story from the outside, we know God is about to do something major. God then makes the same declaration that has been made in the previous chapters, but this time, Sarah hears it because she's eavesdropping at the door of the tent. And when she hears that she's going to have a baby, let's remember that Sarah is every bit of 88 years old at this point. So she's saying to her, she hears this, she laughs inwardly. And she laughs with good reason, with logical reasons. And she gives us three reasons why this sounds ridiculous to her. And the narrator adds one more reason to the story. The first thing she says is, I'm withered. My body don't work like it used to. The second thing she says is, my husband's old. His body don't work like it used to. The third thing she says is like Drew Hill said in 1997, we're not making love no more. I'm just telling you what the Bible said. That's in the text. The fourth reason, which is added by the narrator, is Sarah is menopausal. So let's look at this for a minute. She said, I'm old and withered. My husband is old and withered. We're not doing what it takes to make babies no more. And if we were even able to do what it took to make a baby, I ain't got no more. In Sarah's mind, and hear me clearly, in Sarah's mind, not only is she menopausal, but even when she was having her cycle, she was barren. She couldn't have any children. She was so accustomed to being barren, it became her way of life. She could not conceive of having a child, especially since she's almost 90 old, and Abraham is almost 100 years old. Let me pause right there. Some of us are so accustomed to being barren. Some of us are accustomed to not being productive. Some of us are accustomed to being stopped at a certain level. Some of us are so accustomed to not being able to produce anything, so that even when God comes and tells us that we can do it, we look at God and say, God, you tripping. God, I ain't ever done it before. I was not able to produce before. And now, in this stage of my life, you think I can do something? But once again, I want to ask the question, is there anything too hard for God? Now, God hears the laughter in the spirit, because again, she doesn't do it outwardly. God hears all this in the spirit. And he says to Abraham, what's so funny about her having a baby? Is there anything too wondrous, too difficult, too hard for me to accomplish? And that's where I want to stay for the remainder of this message. Sarah's laughter is because of disbelief. She's laughing because she is basing her belief in what God can do based on what she has experienced, based on what she has seen, based on what she has heard. Let me help somebody today. Just because you haven't seen God do it before doesn't mean God can't do it. Just because you haven't heard God do it before doesn't mean God can't do it. Just because you haven't experienced it doesn't mean that God is not able to do it. Our God is doing things every day for people that never thought they would receive it, never thought they could get it. Just because it hasn't happened to you doesn't mean it can't happen. See, you can't live your life based totally on what you see. That's where faith kicks in. That's where we're reminded that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Some of you are waiting to see something. Some of you are waiting to see something before you believe. Some of you are waiting to hear that it happened to somebody else before you think, oh, it's possible to happen for me. God is about to do something for somebody in this place you've not ever seen, heard, anybody for anybody else. But just because you've never seen or heard of it doesn't mean God can't do it. So again, let's ask the question. What's so funny? Sarah is laughing to herself. She's wondering, how is this possible? Well, let me give you a few reasons why what God is saying is possible. Number one, the promises of God are not always reasonable. The promises of God don't always make sense. We like it when stuff makes sense. We like it when 2 + 2 = 4. We like it when we can walk into a situation and reason our way through it. But there are some things that God is going to tell you that make absolutely no sense. There are some things God will show you that will make no sense. You're going to wonder, how can I do this? I don't have the money. I don't have the manpower. I don't have the human resources. The church is too small. We too broke. We too this. We too that. I'm the only person that's interested. I'm the only person trying. But God's promises are not always reasonable. What God says to you is not always going to make sense in our finite mind. But don't forget, if God created the universe, then God can do what God gets ready to do. God's promises don't always make sense to you. It doesn't mean that God can't do it. Just because you don't understand it does not mean God cannot make it happen. Well, what it means is that you have to walk in some faith. You got to walk in knowing that God has the power to do what God can do. It may not be reasonable. It may not make sense to you. It may not make sense to you that you can win a scholarship that you look like you're not look like you're not eligible for. It may look like that you are going to get a job that you are not eligible for. But let me help you understand something. Sometimes God will put you in a place not because of you so much, but because God is trying to show some people around you. You see, what God does for us is not always just for us. Sometimes God works some things out for us so that everybody around us can see the kind of God that we serve. There's sometimes the things are worked out for us, not just because we need it, but because your son or your daughter needs to see God at work in your life. Your neighbor needs to see God at work in your life. Your mom and your dad. The church folk that told you what was not possible need to see God at work in your life. The person that broke your heart needs to see that, baby, I'm going to keep it moving. Because I serve a God.
That's good. That's good.
That is able. Number two, the promises of God are not always rational. They're not always going to fit into your logic. We like stuff to make sense. We also like things to be logical.
Yeah.
We had a professor at Morehouse, my friend who I'm going to introduce to y'all later, will tell you. Dr. Gore was able to prove that 1 + 1 did not equal 2. The chair of the math department. Somebody's looking at me like, yeah, okay. He's not alive anymore. I wish I could talk to him. But he literally, students that had him, could prove that 1 + 1 = 1.67 something. The point is, it made no rational sense, so nobody wanted to believe it. He had to show them how it was going to happen. But I just want to remind you today, God is not always rational. God created rationality, but God also is not always going to fit into the box that God even created. God is not always going to be rational. It's not always going to be logical to you. We like to go A, B, C, D, E. God may take you from A to F, back to C, over to M, back to B, and then all the way to Z before he gets you to M.
That's right.
And somebody's looking at me like, because you see, sometimes if we take the direct path to what God has for us, we think we did it. Sometimes we got to walk a little bit. We got to walk that circle a little bit. We got to have some detours so we will understand how God is working some things out in our lives. The promises of God are not always rational. No, it was not rational that a 90-year-old and a 100-year-old could conceive and have a baby. Let's think about this for a second. Those of you who are in the medical profession, you know, especially ladies, you know that when you give birth, that's the closest you are to death. Imagine you, if that's what it is when you're 25. Imagine that you're 80, you're 90, and you're going to give birth. Really? Some of y'all can't handle strong drink at 80. You're talking about giving some birth to somebody. It's not logical, it's not rational, but God does not subscribe to our rationality. God does not subscribe to our logic. God is God. God supersedes all of that. Now, those are some issues. And number three, the promises of God are sure. If God said it, then it's done. I could stop right there. Think about that. God is the creator of the universe. If God told you it's going to happen, it's going to happen. If God said that this is where you're going to land, then this is where you are going to land. If God said this is where you are to be, then that's where you are to be. Let me bring it all the way home. If God told you you were healed, it doesn't matter what stage cancer you're in, you will be healed. If God told you you were delivered, it doesn't matter how bound up, how fettered up you are, you will be delivered. If God told you that you're going to pass, you're going to graduate, doesn't matter how many F's are on your transcript, you still going to graduate. Let me help you understand. God, see, the God we serve created the universe. And if God created the universe, then everything God does is going to come to pass. If God said it, then it's definitely going to happen. If God said it, then it will come to pass because we serve a God whose words create. And now this one, I have 4 points today. This one dovetails into my last points. The promises of God are not hindered by our unbelief. I want y'all to think about that for a second. I'm about to help somebody. If you ask for it, you must ask in faith. happen. It doesn't matter if you believe or not. If God said it, it's done. Somebody missed a shout right there. Let me flip that around a different way. The promises of God are not fettered by your unbelief. You don't have to believe what God said, but because God said it, that makes it true. God's words are creative. That means if God tried to lie, the moment it came out of God's mouth, it would have to be true because God is truth. Let me give you this. If I hear right now that there's going to be a three-headed dragon in my driveway when I get home, I don't have to believe it, but I guarantee you, if God said it, when I pull up to 1802, there's going to be a three-headed dragon waiting for me, wondering where I've been. See, when God makes you a promise, your belief or disbelief is not counted, not equated, not in the equation. It's not counted into the equation. Sometimes people will tell you that the promises of God you're missing out on because you don't believe. That's not true. Sarah stood there and laughed in the face of God. And God said, guess what? This time next year, I'm coming back and you're going to have a baby. Whether you believe it or not. You don't have to believe it, but let me help you understand something too. God could have let her have the baby right that moment. God could have said, boom, you're pregnant. But what had to happen, God had to work some stuff out in her. God had to do some things in Sarah. God had to get Sarah's physical ready. God had to get Sarah's spiritual ready before she could have this baby. Let me help you understand something. God could do some things instantaneously, but God, most of the time, got to work inside us and prepare us to receive what it is God has for us. God has to prepare us to receive the promise of God. It doesn't mean the promise is being delayed, but God is a kairos kind of God, which means at the right moment, it's going to happen. God doesn't function in time, but God functions in spiritual moments. It wasn't the right moment for Sarah to have the baby because she wasn't ready to have a baby. But in a year's time, God said, I'm coming back. I'm going to touch Sarah. I'm going to touch Abraham. And this baby is going to be on the way. I just want to remind somebody today. Somebody in here may have actually laughed at God. And you say, God, that ain't going to happen for me. Let me help you understand. Just because you laughed at God, that means it's not going to happen. I just want to remind you today that when God tells you something, it might sound funny, it might sound ridiculous, it might sound outrageous, it might sound crazy, but let me say once again, is there anything too wondrous, too hard, too difficult for God? Is there anything that our God cannot do? Is there anything that our God is not able to master? Is there anything that our God is not able to manage? Is there anything when God, any time when God won't have a victory? Is there any time when God will not come out on top? Is there any time when God will let you fall? Is there any time when God will let you falter? Is there any time when God will let you fall flat on your face? Is there any time when God will allow you to be embarrassed? Is there any time when God will cause you to be hurt? Is there any time when God will do it? Is there anything? See, I'm preaching this one for me right this moment. Because this, I got some anythings that are looking too hard for God. But let me let you know something. Even if I'm struggling with believing it, if God has said to me this is going to happen, then Henry, you need to get your stuff together and just wait